Thank you, Hans, for the very kind introduction. Yeah, in fact, today I want to discuss about language technology for big data analytics. Actually, here in Germany, we have launched a couple of programs, also on the European side, where we see big data as a tradable asset. So today we want to speak also about the economic value of big data volumes, and in a couple of discussions with our government, we said at least from the German point of view, data from production and machine data, that means in manufacturing, are extremely relevant for the German economy. The second thing where we collected a lot of data is mobility, because the automotive industry is very active and we have car-to-X communication. We do logging on cars, also on electrical vehicles. Another third topic we said we should focus on is data from smart grids. You know, with the energy transition in Germany, this is a very important topic, of course, smart metering, smart grid data. And finally, because we are very close to Charité here, individualized medicine, all the data about, you know, in future medical treatment. And here, of course, big data is extremely important. So these are the four main topics from the German point of view. On the other hand, what we observe in general, and this is a link to natural language processing, is that 95% of the zettabyte of digital data which is available is unstructured. These are mostly not very structured data, and especially this unstructured data is, you know, growing exponentially. Therefore, in my talk, I will address first human versus machine-generated big data, then some major German European big data initiatives. I will talk about the role of language technology for big data analytics, and finally, the need for real-time natural language analysis and generation for real application impact. It's clear that in the years to come, the amount of data really will explode, and this is not so much by human generation, but it's mainly machine-generated data. But now many would say, what is the connection to natural language? The connection is that most of this is actually encoded in natural language. Why? Because, of course, humans want to inspect what is going on in the machine-to-machine translation. This is already in manufacturing, of course. The boss of a big factory wants to understand if there's a problem, what's going on. So there is natural language generation involved. And the same, of course, in mobility, in smart grid. So this aspect that also it's machine generated, however it's done in natural language, is very important. And of course, multilingual natural language generation becomes therefore more and more important. Now, in the human-generated arena, it also goes up. It's also exponential, but of course we cannot think that humans are able to generate zettabytes of data every year. There is a limit. However, every minute today, we know that more than 200 million emails are sent. More than 2 million queries to Google are issued. The very important for our analysis later are the Twitter tweets, 100,000 tweets per minute generated. Also in Facebook, posts in Facebook, more than 600,000. So this growth is in parallel to the machine generated stuff. And what is also very important is that we want to have access to these data in natural language. And this is a trend which is a big success. I mean, we worked, I remember, with things like SmartCom, SmartWeb, Theseus in Germany. We worked a lot on this. Unfortunately, now most of the applications come from the US, like Siri on the Apple machines, Google Now, S-Voice from Samsung. The latest is now Cortana from Microsoft. So all the big players in the field of internet for human-generated content have now commercial spoken language access to various degrees to these big data issues. What is still missing, and this is a topic here in Metaform, is cross-lingual information retrieval. All these commercial products don't have this. I think this could be something where Europe has already in research an advantage, but this also should be exploited now in a commercial fashion. Now, if we look back, we can say that natural language processing, of course, was very successful for databases, data warehouses, and of course on the World Wide Web. But this is in the giga and petabyte range. Now with big data, really we strive for the exa and zettabyte range of data. And what is new about it, as I said, it's information which is often, most often unstructured, most often machine generated, but it has also very low information density. So it's really much more important to dig very deep and find the information nuggets. All this new material is not as we are used in the classical data models of high information density. And I think personally that language technology is actually one of the key enablers for big data analytics. First of all, as you all know, information extraction from text, from video and so on, extremely important. But the second aspect is also multimodal interaction in natural language, gaze, gesture with these new services which are based on cloud nets. Now in terms of the exploitation and the use of natural language processing in the context of big data, I think it's of increasing importance that when we move from the classical domain of digital data to big data analytics, that the aspect of real-time decision support becomes extremely important. So this is from the roadmap of Siemens, where they say, you know, big data analytics today goes in the direction of stream processing, smart data engineering, in this range of peta and zettabytes. We really not only have to do retrospective batch analysis, but everything must be in real time. And this means from the application point of view that we are changing from descriptions of the past, descriptive analytics, or in the better case, diagnostic analytics, to real prediction and even more prescriptive. What should we do next in an emergency or alert situation? This means really a challenge for language technology because it has to be incremental and extremely fast. And I think the developments of natural language processing over the last 20 years really go in this direction. Some of them were driven by combining speech and natural language processing. Of course, in speech, as we realized in Verb Mobile from the beginning, you have to be really fast, extremely fast, passing. If you want to integrate symbolic methods, we cannot go back to the old days of batch processing of this. So the speed issue is really crucial here. But let me discuss the role of language technology in a more systematic way, looking at the processing cycle of big data. Before we start with a big data project, of course, we have to search for big data sources. And here, I think the NLP community has something to offer because the organization and search for open data sources and streams was done already because the corpus-based natural language people already had this problem looking for good resources. So we can learn something here. Then the first step is, of course, the collection. And here again, in red, these are the relevant things for language technology, looking at unstructured data, how to organize it, multimodal data, uncertain data, complex events, and, of course, deep web data, all the PDF data and so on, which are not on the surface, of course, have to be collected. But then the real processing starts in the first step of the cycle. We have big data analytics in the data cleansing process, of course, information extraction, semantic analysis, sentiment analysis. These are all things which without natural language processing cannot really work. When we are in the big data maintenance mode, the next step after analysis, annotation and tagging, data validation, redundancy avoidance, consistency checking, And of course, what is not often done right now in big data is even inference and abstraction. So using, for instance, a textual entailment to enrich the big data which originally was collected, I think here again natural language processing comes in. When we talk about data storage and retrieval, this is something which is very well done here in the German industry. Then natural language processing, of course, is not so important, but except densification technologies and aggregation procedures where we compress data, again, we can use knowledge from natural language processing. And finally, the most important from the business point of view is, of course, the exploitation. That means really making use of these things. Decision support in real time, already said. Here we need, of course, natural language processing, prediction, monitoring, alerting, and reporting. I mean, you want to do the monitoring and alerting for people. So I think in the end, of course, very fast incremental natural language event description is of essence. Otherwise, people don't have the benefits. Right now in Germany we are preparing a second future project. These future projects are directly commissioned, so to speak, by the government. It's various ministries, of course the Ministry of Dr. Görler, but also of the Ministry for Research and Education. They come together and the funding, it's not a single project, but it's a funding stream. And so we are preparing something for smart services. We call it Service Digital right now as a working title. It's internet-based services for the economy. And here again, let me say that building up on a cloud infrastructure where we have a platform as a service, we have, of course, the infrastructure as a service as a basic layer, we now set up things which are important for business designers, like business process as a service. But now the red part is the most important, we think, namely big data as a service, that we really bring big data into the process of knowledge workers in economy. And even one step higher, we go, as people on the Siemens roadmap say now, we go from big data to smart data to knowledge, because the knowledge also has to be a service which we can provide. And of course, this will be not for free in most cases. This is an added value where you can have also build a business on this. Now, in Germany, we already had some official national conferences. The first one was arranged by the Federal Ministry of Education in June. It was entitled Big Data, Exploring Data, Treasures in Science and Industry. We had a summit by Bitkom in Bonn, and coming up is a second very important conference here on the 11th and 12th of November. I guess that Dr. Görler already has announced it, Big Data Potentials for Germany. And we just discussed, we are preparing also a session with CEOs in Hamburg on the so-called IT Summit. This is the biggest IT gathering of all the CEOs of both big companies and small and medium enterprises. So a lot is coming up. In terms of funding, the BMBF has already announced a call for proposal. This was on the 12th of July for 2 to 3 national big data competence center each for about research in the 5 to 10 years perspective. So it's more application oriented basic research which is intended here. The finalist selection, 9 centers have applied. The final selection was done on the 12th September, but the senior expert jury will decide finally on these centers in the second half of November, and then the announcement will be done according to the ministry on the 10th of December during the IT summit. So these centers, each of it has between 7 to 10 million euro, so it's quite a large effort, national effort, to have such competence centers. This is one thing. The second is that there are also consortia projects being launched now. Deadline was also 12th of July, so this will is more applied research also starting next year. And then finally, a very big and involved program with the emphasis, which is typical, I think, for your office here, also SME involvement and even more applied, real looking even to really gain commercial success. This will be launched, we just discussed, we hope, in November, we hope, depending on the election. Now, on the European level, we have the big program, which is a coordination and support action with 11 partners. Here, the goal is to really define the roadmap for big data technologies. I think Marta has already talked about it yesterday. This is a project where we are involved, and we are on the way to define this roadmap, both on a sector basis, so the different industrial sectors, and also to try to find an integrated cross-sectional roadmap. Now, let me give you some examples of where I think is really the benefit of natural language processing. One I thought is very interesting for you because it is linked to the election. You know, on Sunday, here we have the big national election, and there is, the Wirtschaftswoche is one of the leading weekly magazines, and they have set up a webpage which is called the Net Elects, where every day you see, yeah, the fluctuation between voters. It's on parties, of course, but also dealing with candidates. Here, the two top candidates are compared. The top tweets are analyzed, and this is done using massively natural language technology, because it's done completely automatically. It just looks at tweets and Facebooks and tries to find out what is the current movement under the people who go to the election. So 10,000 tweets are first harvested from the 400 million every day, being relevant. This is a rough analysis. Also 17,000 Facebook entries per week. And then advanced natural language processing is done. One of, it's not only just simple tagging, parsing, and so on, but it's also an information extraction, but it has a quite a sophisticated negation analysis, of course. Very important negation. If you find something, you have to look, yeah, is this a positive or negative comment, and what about negation? Counterfactuals, because a lot of people, when they say something, yeah, they discuss what if, yeah, if, yeah, the Liberal Party, yeah, is elected or not, what happens, what are coalitions, and so on. And of course, comparatives, very important if you compare people, parties, and so on. All this has to be done. And if you can check the page, it's online, it's updated every day, and you see it's very interesting to watch this. Why I mention this is, first of all, this is one of our spin-offs. Actually, it was based on Hans's work originally. It's a company which is called Attensity. They are in DFKI in Saarbrücken, in an incubation center. But the guy who has done the advanced analysis, both first worked for Dr. Körler in his program thesis, so he learned a lot about these things. Second, he also worked in the big data roadmap, and now he joined a company, which is a good, I think, a good way to work. And he has now a very practical tool in big data, namely big data election prediction. Election prediction by automatic natural language processing. Now, this tweet analysis, I think, is very important because it's also should be multilingual in the long run. And for disaster management, I'm on the board of the National Institute of Informatics in Tokyo, and was there in April. And there they showed me a very interesting thing, namely a 1.5 million Twitter message analysis. In this case, still post hoc, not during the earthquake, but what was really fascinating is that the first tweets You know the famous 11th March 2011 Fukushima event. The first tweets were long before anything was on the news channels or so on. A guy already said earthquake. This was a second later delay because somebody, you know, realized it's shaking and sent this message. And in this case, very short, only 1 hour. Then the same happened on the Earth iPhone in English, because there are a lot of foreigners in Japan. And only, some seconds later, already the first English message came in. Huge earthquake, yeah, in Tokyo, we are affected. And what I found also extremely interesting was the first tsunami eyewitness was 6 minutes after the earthquake. So nobody had expected tsunami, but there was one guy running around with his smartphone and showing the tsunami coming, typing in very short message, I can see tsunami coming in Japanese carrier. So what do I want to say with this is that in the future, if we really are able to do this in an online, ad hoc, very fast fashion, I think these systems for emergency management, because you see all over what is happening, even the reactor problem itself, yeah, was, you know, in the press, it was 3 days later. Here, yeah, it's a delay of about 1 minute only. The first people already realize something is going wrong. Yeah. So I think that this is very important to collect wisdom from all the people via such social network analysis with natural language processing. This goes on. Even alerting for public health and events. You may have heard about the Biocaster. This is a system which is online. You can check it out. I have the web page here, NII again. And for hay fever and seasonal influenza, again, the system tries, looking at Twitter messages in real time, to find out where is the tendency, how is the influenza or the hay fever spreading out. Again, very useful technology. What we need, I think, in Europe is now an alignment of the different things which are going on. In Germany, we have this Industry 4.0, a 400 million euro program, very big program, sponsored by various ministries, but heavily, of course, by the German manufacturing industry. This produces extreme amount of data. Last year, it was 3.5 petabyte of data, as I said, machine generated, but most of it was in natural language formulated by machines. Second, we have the new coming up service digital, smart services. We already have the trusted cloud, which forms the basis. And now in Europe, we have on the one hand side future internet PPP and the big data PPP. And I think we have to bring this together. Why? Because I think Europe and Germany in particular has the unique chance really to be here ahead. Because if you look at it, we have with a company like Software AG, the biggest, second German, biggest German software company worldwide, with Terracotta, a big data platform which is really unique and is used a lot, as I will show in a minute. The second, all of you know SAP HANA, second product which has its origin here in Europe. We have the Stratosphere system, very good academic system, which is sponsored both here by the government but also by EIT and is headquartered, so to speak, here in Berlin with Professor Markel, who is a driving force behind it, but it's an open software. And then we have by the Future Internet PPP what's called FIware, Future Internet Ware. And here also very interesting, it's a catalog where you can download so-called big data generic enablers. These are software systems which are packaged in such a way that you can combine, and this is what we need. You combine the big data thing, for instance, with a complex event generic enabler, because often, yeah, complex event analysis from sensor streams are important enabler for big data. And what I envisioned for your community would then be also a generic enabler for some of the basic natural language information extraction technologies. This is in a catalog, so you can build them together like Lego blocks to have a complex smart internet application. This is the idea, and we just opened a so-called open innovation lab, and there's a shared trial facility, also including here Berlin and Saarbrücken, where we already test new software applications with industry, building on this so-called generic enablers. I think it's a very good European model, and I think you don't see something like this in other parts of the world. So we have a chance to bring this to commercial success. Even more important, that many people don't know, that if you go today to a Visa transaction worldwide, or PayPal in the internet, this is done already by this technology with terracotta. And there's also even some simple natural language processing going on. More than 100 million of fraudulent credit card transactions could be stopped with this. The big data system reduced the fraud processing time to 20 milliseconds, because this is very important. When you issue yourself a PayPal command, you want to do a transaction, buy something, you don't want to wait forever, yeah, because your internet may break down even in a smartphone, before you get the approval of the transaction. So when you really want to check for fraud, first you have really extremely large big data issue. This is all the transaction records, all. Yeah, not your personal, all. And then second, 4,000 fraud detection rules are fired in real time. And all this in 20 milliseconds, yeah, because you can't wait. So, and here also the sales items. What are you doing? Because this is, you know, in text, what are you buying right now, purchasing, is compared, yeah, with your behavior. There are many rules which go down to the sales item. Of course, here we have very fast extraction methodology from the transaction file. And this is now deployed. It's not a test. This is in real life. It's done, and it's done with software which was developed here. Second very interesting example is that you also can change your business models. Dr. Helbig is also in our group designing the new project. He is the CIO of DHL, and he has had the idea that the Deutsche Post or DHL has so much knowledge from their natural language CRM reports of the people who bring parcels, that this information which is stored could be used as a new business. And what they do is actually that they provide a service called GeoVista, where you can estimate the earning opportunities by analyzing the business potential of a certain area here in Berlin or everywhere where DHL is working. So you see big data as a kind of tradable assets, because they extracted the relevant information for the decision, where should I put my next hotel, McDonald's, bakery, whatever, a chain? Is there really the consumer space there? And of course, they have this knowledge indirectly in their files, and they extract it, package it in another way, and then sell it. So they have another benefit. Finally, let me say that in the context of EIT, the European Institute of Technology, which I also worked a lot to launch this, we go even a step further. We think that you have to bring various big data sources together in various layers. If you do, for instance, intelligent urban management, yeah, you have to look at so many different sources. And we tried this now for Trento in a very big experiment. We say big data territory. All the data are collected, and then we want to have a service. It's not a surveillance or NSA-like service. It's really a service for the benefit of the people living in the Trento area. It's controlled by the Trentino government. And what is interesting about it is that these different layers here, from telecommunication, energy, transportation, are brought together to have a 360-degree view of what's going on. And just the cross-link between these data are the most important. And we are heavily involved in this, because Trento is a test field, but it's done by groups from Germany, from France, from Finland, from the Netherlands, and from Sweden right now. Last example, again from DFKI. This is an example which was very nicely used, both in London during the Olympics and the Lord's Mayor Show, but also recently, this April, at the coronation of the new Dutch king, big mass events, where what we do is, again, people can send via app their ad hoc observation. And in the case of the coronation, more than 75,000 people had this app and were posting messages about what they observe. These messages are analyzed, and from these messages we can do a very good crowd management. Yeah. For instance, we can predict that some subway station will be too crowded, we have to close it down, we have to give personal navigation messages, please go to the next subway station, and so on. So it's added value services on both sides, and for crowd management, this is, I think, a very good application. Let me conclude. I think what I showed is that big data technologies are a real innovation motor. First of all, for industry, second, of course, also for science, and maybe also for government. Real-time, multilingual natural language analysis and generation, as well as translation technologies, are a key enabler for this. Without this, I think there will be no success in big data. Second, key research challenges are smart tools for real-time analytics, decision support. I think we the real-time aspect for me is the most important, which is a commercial differentiator. Because if you say we can deliver this in 1 week or so, it doesn't really make a difference to current practice. And intelligent information extraction from unstructured data, of course, is the focus. Europe's, and I would say in particular Germany's, strengths in big data technology. Yeah, there are no competitors. There is no HANA from the United States. There is no Terracotta and so on. So in in-memory computing platforms and open source platforms like the Future Internetware Generic Enabler or Stratosphere are very good platforms. And if we add the multilingual language technologies which are developed by you in the Meta Forum, I think this is a really a very competitive thing, and my impression from visiting Japan and recently also US is that everybody looks to what's going on here. So I think we have a chance really to be the first mover here. In Germany, the focus on big data applications is both for Industry 4.0, for smart grids, and advanced mobility and personalized medicine. And I think these are the areas where also, if you think about personalized medicine, if you think about mobility, I think without also human understandable messages, this will not be acceptable at all, especially the medical establishment when they see something which is only coded and then not really written in their own terminology, they will not accept it. So I think language, again, is very important here. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Wolfgang, for your talk. Yesterday, we gave the audience, after the keynote, to ask a few questions. And although you all know that we are already borrowing time, but everybody is in debt today, we shouldn't worry. So we would give you also the opportunity of a few questions. But it has to be short questions, please. There was one behind, and then Jochen, I guess.
Yes, okay. My name is Günther Tau from the company TBS. I would like to put a little bit salt in the big data soup you have presented to us, because especially since the cloud problem is an industry, a very important problem, especially after NSA and PRISM. And there was a nice article in The Economist, especially as in UK, they don't have to deal a little bit with privacy or security regarding smart cities. And there is an app in the Netherlands which has not yet coming to the market, which gives us a chance to find out the places in Amsterdam where you can easily get cheap bikes, laptops, and can steal some interesting tourists. So I would say, you know, if we are looking too much on the hype of big data, we have to include the problem of privacy, because this is will comes up in the next 2 or 3 years, absolutely, here in Germany and all over in the world. Because, you know, the case is, you know, just 2 days before, the president of Brazil, Rousseff, was announcing that they are starting with an individual web, because they don't trust anymore the server in the US.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think this topic is so important that I didn't address it. I think it's in the awareness of everybody. And of course, this is a major concern. But I think there is no conflict here, because I think in Europe, we are especially aware of this. And there are a lot of countermeasures. And as you say, we have, I already mentioned, Trusted Cloud. There is a lot of talk about the European cloud, Schengen cloud. And there are so many initiatives to try to shield this. So I think we should not, I mean, we should address the problem, but I think it's an orthogonal problem. We have to work with clouds anyway, yeah, and also with big data. And I think we cannot allow to stop all the research only because now we have the NSA. This is a political problem, and it's very hard to solve. But I think we cannot stop the process, and I don't know what you suggest. I mean, the problem awareness everybody here in the audience has, including, of course, myself, we are fighting back, but I don't see any relation to what I presented here. Of course, you always should have in mind privacy and security are extremely important issues. We work on it.
My name is Jochen Hummel from his team. I have a bit more technical question. You were talking about language technology, and at the end you said translation technology. How do you see the high-level architecture? So when I want to do big data analysis, what shall I do? Shall I just take the tweets in the different languages and machine translate and then use the existing tools which are good in doing sentiment analysis in English? Or shall I rather try to language enable these tools so that they do directly the analysis in the different languages and the original language?
That's a very good question. From the technical point of view, I think the second variant in the long run would of course be ideal. However, as we know, it's very hard to achieve. My experience in WorldMobile was that it works to a limited degree. I mean, in the end, we had several engines which were really kind of where we abstracted away from a specific language and could parameterize it. But of course, as we all know, in linguistics, there are so much fundamental differences. For instance, when we started with Chinese and with Japanese language, our experience was that it's not very easy to have one core engine which is parameterized. That's, I think, the reality, but I agree completely. As far as we can go, we should try it. We should come up, as I said, with a generic enabler, building blocks, where you can do this. Maybe we have a chance for several European languages to do this, but I think for the time being, from a commercial point of view, I think people will try to get what they get from off the shelf products first, because there's a need, as I said. And here, I think that the most important ingredient is the high speed. And my experience, again, from WorldMobile is, and other projects, once you begin to parameterize, it's also sometimes a little bit slower. I mean, we know this, when we are more on an abstract level, you always lose a little bit of time. You have maybe to compile it in a specific language-specific solution. But I agree, from a scientific point of view and even commercial, it would be good if we have some generic enablers. I mean, for morphology, for instance, a morphology engine, even parsing, I think it is possible, but other things, I'm a bit more skeptical.
Thank you very much again. We need to move on.